From the shelter-in-place studio of Leslie Jackson, welcome to this special video episode of The Leslie Show, in which I talk to flute player and shredder extraordinaire Rebecca Kleinmann from her place just a few miles away. This video episode is a follow-up to an audio show in which Rebecca and I dive into her foundations in music and into her education. You can find links to that show in the show notes. In this video, she plays her flute a lot, and we hear about some of her practice routines, and she announces a couple of upcoming shows. Please enjoy my interview with Rebecca Kleinmann.
So that's a choro by Pixinguinha, and it's called Nekeli Tempo, which I translate as back in the day.
What you working on otherwise?
I am doing a bunch of recording. I'm preparing for a show, finally. It's been a while since I said that. I have a birthday show coming up on November 14th at the Sound Room. 7 p.m. Pacific time. The way to find that is soundroom.org.
Okay. We'll also link to that in the show notes. And we buy tickets in advance. We just show up and hit a pay button once we're in there. How does that work?
Actually, it might be free and with donations, I think, so you can watch it on Facebook or YouTube. Okay. But then, yeah, if you can, please donate so I can pay my musicians,
please.
Who are amazing. It's going to be My special guest is Tiffany Austin on vocals.
Oh, love Tiffany Austin. I've seen you two perform together at the piano store.
Oh, that's right. And then Tammy Hall on piano, who was also on that same show. And then do you know Pasoka, Will Martins?
No.
Great pandeiro player. Yeah, a great Brazilian pandeiro player who's been here for a while, and he's kind of back and forth between Brazil. I've even performed with him in Brazil. You know, when I was going to choose who I wanted to play that show, my birthday show, and what I thought was going to be my first gig since March, you know, I really wanted to pick people who were not only musical companions of mine that I feel really comfortable and excited about playing with, but also people who are friends. There's a connection and a support and just a joy of, you know, there's a special friendship there with each of those three people, Tammy Hall and Pasoka, Will Martins, and Tiffany. So that's, you know, it's my birthday. I just want to have fun. I want to relax and play music that I love. And so that was really important to me to pick people. Of course, I had to make it small. I couldn't pick all the people who fit that description. But it's a very odd instrumentation, you know, just piano, percussion, light percussion, and voice and flute.
One of the things I love about choro is how you can, it's hard to play, but you can have the tunes. Like, I've had the tunes in my head for probably 25 years because I've been listening to it, and they feel like there's a standard quality to them. I love
Yeah, there definitely is this repertoire of tunes that's standard. And then as you get deeper into it, you try to find the weird, obscure ones.
Do you know this one called Vu Vivendo? I'm sure I'm pronouncing it wrong. Yeah.
Right, need some review, but I got it.
I love that tune. I love it because for me, I just learned it. And it takes me to places on the fretboard that I don't often go. There's that great shift with the C sharp. And then the last part feels like it's a different tune, but then you loop back in again. When you put a grace note into this stuff, how do you decide when and where and whether to put those in? And is that part of the tune for you? It's just exactly how you hear it.
Yes, it's part of the style. So it's part of what, when I listen to recordings, I like to grab the embellishments that Jacob de Mandoline or Pichinguinha would do and add them in and learn them, but also not be tied down to them because they can get repetitive. If you always do the same embellishment in the same place, it can get boring, but it's also, you know, a kind of subtle way to change it up every time you play it, especially if there aren't that many melody players and you want to vary it every time you play it. So I try to be flexible with where I put those and I improvise them. And I kind of look at it similar to what you might find in the time of Bach and the flute playing from that time, because that there's a very subtle improvisation in that, and just like the way you tongue those notes, or even just like the shape of the vowel that you create as you play. And it changes the sound. I studied a little bit of Baroque flute, and so there's these subtle ways that you bring your own personality into that are stylistic. And I think of it as something similar in choro. Like if I stray too far and I do something too weird, I'm kind of taking it out of choro. But if I tastefully put in some embellishments here and there and not every single possible one, then it kind of just keeps the interest of the ear.
Can you play an example of sort of some of this, a Baroque tonguing technique that might change the flavor of?
I'll just take this one phrase from the E flat box nada. Right, so I could play it like that, or I could play with a more sort of pointed articulation. And it gives it a different feeling, right? So yeah. It's just that I just basically changed like the shape of my tonguing from my articulation from ta the second time. The first time it was more like da. It's a more round shape. And it changes the tone, or it changes the articulation, the very first thing that you hear from the note.
What else have you been working on? So you're preparing for a show. You haven't played a show in 6 months or?
Yeah, since March. And actually, this was going to be my first show, the November 14th thing. But then Grupo Falso Baiano, the shoulder group, snatched me up for a gig that's going to be even before that, which is November 7th, which I'm actually playing a live gig with an audience. And then something else I've been just working on, my own education. I've been studying with a great bass player, Ichiberis Warg, in Rio, and he's Ermeto Pascual's bass player. And also he and his family were super kind to me when I was on my last trip to Brazil. They invited me for Christmas. That was my one, but you know, I didn't want to be by myself on Christmas, and I happened to mention that I was going to be there in Rio, and they invited me to their Christmas dinner. Their family, his kids are about my age, and they're Arjurina is the great drummer in the Ermeto band as well. And his daughter, also about my age, she's a great flute player. And we really connected. We had connected before, but this time we really connected. And she came and sat in with me on my gig in Rio. So we have a cool connection now. This is just a homework assignment from the class, but it's an arrangement.
Please do. Mm-hmm.
So here, the rules were to take the song and take each chord and choose the voicings. And his philosophy is just really simple. You go through every permutation you can with the voicings, and you choose the one that's most beautiful to you. So this is Awesome Preto. Cool. It's a Baião by Luis Gonzaga. And I arranged it for 5 parts.
There's my homework assignment. I did my homework. Were the other voicing this that you had a choice of kind of close seconds, or was it just so clear to you when you heard this one? Oh yeah, that's my favorite one.
That was one of the restrictions of the exercise too, was keep them really close to each other.
Oh God.
So my first instinct actually was I wrote a way more spread out, and then and I just sent it to him in the computer program in Sibelius, and he said, no, try that. The exercise is to put the voices pretty close together. The melody is always on top and they're moving in blocks. Oh, that was the other part of it. He wanted us, the exercise was to harmonize every single note of the melody, so you don't just have the chord and the melody moving. So that's why it's moving like that.
How cool. And how cool that when Rebecca Kleinmann takes a lesson, this is what it's in.
He's actually getting away from like the rules of theory and going more with harmony itself. He keeps on saying, internalize the sounds. So it's a lot of the work that I do through this process is internalizing the sounds of the chords, right? The actual sounds of the chords in different inversions. And then, you know, if I do that enough, hopefully get to the point like, you know, Ermeto Pascual and him and other genius composers, they can sit down with a piece of paper and a pencil and hear the music in their head while they write it out. They don't need to touch an instrument. I'm not there yet.
It's like reading to yourself. Like when you read a book, your lips move when you first start reading. And then you move to where you can read a book without your lips moving. You can actually experience the emotion of the letters going past.
Yeah, that's a good, I like that.
one of the first things that all musicians did when the shelter in place came down was jump on to multi-screen multiplayer shows. Thank you. and to like exhaustion. But you were one of the first that I saw, and your shows were actually really good. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't just the thing for the thing's sake, but they were pieces that you could jump up and dance to. I did. And what was that process like? And did you resist? Did you dive right in? Does someone else do the editing?
Well, at first I dove right in because I was just, you know, used to gigging every week, lots of gigs per week and just playing. And so the first thing I wanted to do was just kind of stay connected with my friends and collaborate. So I think even just that first week that we all were sheltering in place, I did a few and I kind of cranked them out fast.
There are tunes, some of which I know and play myself. So they're super inspiring in that way. It did not inspire me to try to do the same thing because I know what's involved.
I actually prefer focusing on audio recording and just recording straight into Pro Tools and then being able to listen back to takes that I want and just decide and, you know, and then meld that with video because it gives me more sonic control. It gives me more possibilities. So I prefer that artistically for sure. Yeah. But, you know, that was fun. I'm not doing too many of those acapellas anymore, but that was fun to kind of just crank through some.
And participate right away. You're used to collaborating. You're used to doing shows. Yeah. So hopefully this begins kind of a flood of performances when, whether things open up or not, that we'll be able to go out and see you play live. I joked with someone that if they were playing at the Sound Room, I didn't want to watch them on a computer. I was going to show up and watch them through the window from outside. I wanted to ask you something. Do we have time? I have these, you know, as a drummer, you get this printout of a list of rudiments. As a fiddle player, I have a printout of a list of bowing exercises. And last time you talked about something called the essential flute quarantine routine.
This comes from one of my classical flute teachers, Jill Felber, who's an amazing classical flutist. And it's really transforming my sound, and I'm just now at the beginning of being pretty disciplined with doing them every single day. So I'm excited to see what happens because it's increasing my breath control. It's increasing my confidence with just the attack of the note, each note in any register, and also speed and agility. You know, there's all kinds of things that it addresses in sort of a compact form. I've got now to where I can do the exercises in a sort of fast, condensed way. Before, I was just studying each exercise a lot with my students so that I could kind of dive into the details of each exercise. And now that I understand, well, I'm only halfway through. We can see there's several that I haven't started touching yet until I feel really solid on the first ones. But yeah, it's a good study, and it's not something that's giving me some structure to my practice.
Yes.
And then I'm also doing some other pattern-based work for building patterns for improvising from a book by Gabriel Grossi, who's a great harmonica player. It's called Transform Your Musical Mind. And I highly recommend it. And he has some meditations that you listen to in the morning that kind of give you confidence and the right attitude towards practice. And then going into practice in a pretty systematic way, but playful also. I like the way he's balancing the natural connection with music with some discipline. And then he has all these, for instance, like pentatonic patterns.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm just diving into that as well. So I'm trying to do some foundation work just to keep my chops growing, you know.
You never run out of things to learn as a musician. It's so great to hear. Yeah. Keep going. I love that about music. And I love that about musicians who still feel fresh and humble about it, that there's more to learn. Yeah.
There's always more to learn. Yeah. Oh, there's so much to learn.
Rebecca, this has been brief and awesome. And I'm really looking forward to the Sound Room show. Glad to see you feeling good and still staying positive and musical.
Thank you. Yeah, I think the music is at the center of me staying sane. And if I ever am kind of losing it because things are so crazy, I just come back to the music. Even if it's, you know, that's what's really helpful about these sort of methodical things is there, I can just, if I need to just stop thinking about how crazy the world is or how upset I am about something, I can just dive into something really methodical. Etc.
The refuge of rudiments. Happy birthday, Rebecca.
Thank you.
Yeah, looking forward to seeing you at this show and further musical conversations. This is so rich for me.
Yeah, likewise. Thank you so much, Leslie.
Thank you.
All right, take care.
You too. Bye.
Bye.
You're listening to The Leslie Show.